Hello and welcome to another episode of Death Drive Dialectics. I'm Tyler, here with Nick, and we bring you the next episode of our series on cyberpunk edgerunners. In the last episode, we used Deleuze and Guattari's theory of schizophrenia and the body without organs to help us understand the main character David's transformation from a regular guy to a schizoid cyborg. In this episode, we will challenge Deleuze and Guattari's theories of schizophrenia and the body without organs using Baudrillard's theories of hyperreality and the code to help us cultivate a better understanding of the system or the structure that David occupies in Cyberpunk Edgerunners. Let's get started. First things first, what is Baudrillard's theory? In his many works on the orders of simulation, hyperreality, the code, economies of reproduction, algorithmic encodic languages, Baudrillard charts a historical shift in the way material production and language determine value, in the way they function, in the way they influence and affect our societies and individuals. For our contemporary society, Baudrillard describes a social body under arrest, where movement is everywhere unleashed, but within a hypercurved, non-Euclidean space of collapsed distances that inflects all social forces, such as production, culture, politics, back into themselves. He describes systems of deterrence that paradoxically restrain us through inundation with choice, operating at breakneck speeds through networks of immersive media, microdata, and generative models, irradiating into every channel of social life. Hyperreal mediums no longer aim at delivering a particular message or content, but instead aim at penetrating and circulating, continuously prompting the user to provide a message, any message. In this non-linear curve dimension, all distinctions collapse. And the world of cyberpunk, and Night City in particular, occupy this kind of collapsed space. Every aspect of Night City society and social relations is recorded by a system of datafication and is simultaneously manipulated and reproduced according to algorithmic models generated by this unfathomable flow of information. Statistics. Night City's political economy runs on data circulation, and all political conflicts are engineered data cold wars. The political economy of Night City was preceded by and is continuously reproduced according to models that sustain and are in turn sustained by the circulation of data. Brain dances and other immersive technologies, typifying Baudrillard's theory of hyperreal mediums and simulation, remove all limits to desire and subsequently gravitate users around their never satisfied desires. These hyperreal mediums create a perfect state of deterrence, passivity, and are achieved through consistent probing, feedback, and adjustment. The content of all desires and actions is dissolved and made to circulate into models, producing more and more valuable information. Now, all that might sound a bit abstract and unfamiliar, but next, we'll be giving some context to the fundamentals of Baudrillard's theory and exactly how he combines materialist and linguistic analysis. And then we'll be getting into the show to demonstrate exactly how Baudrillardian Night City is. Let's give an overview of the foundations on which these Baudrillardian theories rest in linguistic and materialist analysis. Baudrillard observes, both in economics and language, a shift in how value is produced, a shift in the determinants of value in both. This leads him to write some seemingly exaggerated statements like the end of labor, the end of production, the end of political economy, the end of the signifier/signified dialectic, which facilitates the accumulation of knowledge and meaning. At the same time, the end of the exchange value/use value dialectic, which is the only thing that makes accumulation and social production possible. The end of the linear dimension of discourse, the end of the linear dimension of the commodity, the end of the era of production. Baudrillard is arguing that the dialectic, which once sustained the determinancy of signification and the determinancy and regulation of exchange, has now been destabilized. and has disrupted the capacity to generate meaning and to generate useful products, to move forward through history, to produce history. Value is no longer determined by the term's structural relation to all other terms, or its difference to all other terms, but is instead determined by the term's capacity to circulate and its speed. In this sense, the rules have changed for how value is determined. The space that the term and its value occupies has changed, such that point A occupies the same space as point B, both commutable with each other, interchangeable. In this non-linear curve dimension, distinctions collapse. True and false, labor and leisure, usefulness and uselessness, human and machine, resistance and complacency, consumption and production, all absorbed and operationalized under the code to benefit a new form of value. Thought through Deleuze's terms of deterritorialization and reterritorialization, Deleuze's version of deterritorialization is perhaps more radical, or the first step toward a radical society and subjectivity. For Baudrillard, deterritorialization is a method of control, a means of deterring or reducing the society's, the individual, the people's capacity to change their conditions, to act and to think in a way that's new or novel. So for Deleuze, deterritorialization, fragmentation, the elimination of the boundaries of the subject of social production is radical, but for Baudrillard, this is only another means or another method of control. The hyperreal world that Baudrillard describes is suspended in orbit, and so Baudrillard and Deleuze both describe an accelerating and fragmenting society. However, Baudrillard's version of acceleration is orbital, whereas Deleuze's is multilinear. Deleuze imagines these radical trajectories that can escape to a utopian alterity, free from the organs of language, social hierarchies, and repression. Deleuze sees cybernetic acceleration as eruptive, productive, and vital. Baudrillard's alternate conception of this acceleration, fragmentation, is implosive, removing the limits that gave society its capacity to change, to move forward. Baudrillard's alternate conception exposes the limits of the schizo-revolutionary process. Baudrillard states, "Everywhere what has been liberated so that it can enter a state of pure circulation, so that it can go into orbit." Baudrillard would most likely say that Deleuze's schizo-revolutionary subject is a prefigured model, simply existing as a data point within a matrix of algorithmic control. This brings us to the world of cyberpunk, specifically Night City, where David's story takes place. Night City started as an experimental passion project of a wealthy businessman, Robert Knight, who sought to resolve the social turmoil of his time and the impending economic collapse of the 1990s by building a new politically autonomous city that operated under the principles of techno-optimism and corporatocracy. The entirety of David's story takes place in Night City 80 years later, now a densely populated and self-reliant city-state, rife with crime, poverty, and corruption. All social institutions in Night City are privatized, and access to healthcare, housing, education, etc. is mediated through a complex techno-bureaucratic system of memberships, packages, and subscriptions. Corporate interests have always reigned supreme in Night City, a metropole built by the corporation for the corporation.
In the world of Night City, everyone is a cyborg. As David strolls through the slums of Night City, even the homeless have cyberware and are fully immersed in simulated realities. With each cyberware implant, accompanying software is also installed into the user's nervous system, allowing for seamless communication between the body's organic and inorganic components. With these new components, users can access various kinds of media without the need for a physical screen or interface. Because of the pervasiveness of cyberware, every aspect of the body and of social life is logged, tracked, and algorithmically analyzed for the advertised purpose of improving and adjusting the product. Life in Night City consists of incessant communication flowing in and out of bodies. The subject is enveloped and infiltrated by a network of data flows. The economy of Night City relies on the subject turned cyborg, or the subject turned hyper-efficient consumer and producer of data, the user or the individual, the subject reduced to a number. The most popular form of media is the brain dance, a simulated immersive reality contained within a small chip that can be inserted directly into the consumer's body and played in the consumer's mind. Brain dances are recordings of others' sought-after experiences that include all sensory perceptions, such as touch, smell, taste, and temperature. Consumers of brain dances can consume all sorts of experiences, everything from sexual experiences to the lives of celebrities to religious experiences, such as the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Extreme brain dances are a form of sadistic, hyperreal pornography that touches on the subjectivity of the consumer by allowing them to live out extreme acts of real violence, such as mass murder or torture. David is an extreme brain dance fetishist who seeks out the most extreme brain dances. At the beginning of the show, we see David watching a new extreme brain dance created by famous XBD producer Jimmy Karasaki, depicting a cyber-psycho's violent last moments. The cyber-psycho in the extreme brain dance is James Norris, the last wielder of the Sandevistan before David. In the extreme brain dance, James Norris is in cyber-psychosis and is murdering the police in a Grand Theft Auto-style rampage that ends with his death at the hands of MaxTac security forces. In episode 5, Jimmy Karasaki, the extreme brain dance director, kidnaps David with the intent of triggering, recording, and directing his cyber-psychotic rampage and profiting off of his extreme brain dance. After being thwarted by David's gang and tied up, Karasaki states that David too will eventually succumb to cyberpsychosis, just like James Norris. As David objects to Karasaki's claims, he peruses through Karasaki's collection of Edgerunner series extreme brain dances from 1 to 31, ending with Norris's, and then focusing on the empty Edgerunner series number 32, while Karasaki states, "It always ends one of two ways. Either you lose yourself forever or die," anticipating David's death and its eventual transformation into a highly sought-after extreme brain dance. In Simulacra and Simulation, Baudrillard states, "It is certainly a question of a tactile universe, no longer a visual or discursive one, and the people are directly implicated in a process, to manipulate, to be manipulated, to circulate, to make circulate, which is no longer of the order of representation, nor of distance, nor of reflection. Media and messages no longer operate according to the representational logic of the gaze and persuasion, but according to a logic of virality that opens, penetrates, and directly manipulates the subject, their body, and their desires." Baudrillard traces the development of media and its deepening penetration of the subject through new technologies of tacticality that reach beyond the screen, placing the subject within a piece of media and the media within the subject. The implosion of the medium into the subject creates a hyperreal feedback loop of desire. Brain dances are hyperreal insofar as they simultaneously represent and generate reality, blurring the boundaries between representation and reality. Brain dances are an implosive form of media that collapses the subject-object distinction which once separated media and reality and sustained the possibility of generating meaning. Within the hyperreal social environment produced by brain dances, a switch from the panoptic mechanism of surveillance to a system of deterrence is inaugurated, in which the distinction between the passive and the active is abolished. There is no longer any imperative of submission to a model or to the gaze. You are the model. Such is the watershed of hyperreal sociality, in which the real is confused with the model. Brain dances and extreme brain dances help to reproduce the system of control within Night City. The illusion of freedom through fulfilling one's fantasies is a basic operation of consumer capitalism and is epitomized by brain dances and their production of fantasy and the promise of its attainment. Brain dances offer the user the freedom to live out their desires without limit, yet these desires are pre-modeled, anticipated, and integrated into a system of control and deterrence. Even desires or fantasies of escape and emancipation are manipulated and made to orbit within the society of control.
Again, Baudrillard describes a new regime of media which has gone beyond the representational or the gaze, a regime of tactility. This directly involves the body, not its manipulation or its positioning in space, but the way the body is penetrated, the way data and networks enter the body and the body enters networks. In the cyberpunk genre, the body becomes a canvas upon which the consequences of advanced technology and hyperreality are vividly depicted, effectively translating Baudrillard's occasionally abstract ideas into violent and visceral experiences. Often overlapping with body horror, the body in cyberpunk is continuously opened, invaded, fragmented, and reconfigured. Rather than implementing modern ideological apparatuses and targeting the subject with propaganda, rhetoric, and representation-based mediums, hyperreal society maintains streamlined networks of micro-manipulations that direct their focus with surgical precision upon the body and transform it into a, quote, silent, mental, already molecular body, a body metabolized directly, without the mediation of the act or the gaze, an immanent body, a sensory but not sensible body, because it is connected only to its internal terminals, and not to the objects of perception, a body already homogeneous at this stage of plastic tactility, of mental malleability. Cyberpunk Edgerunners clearly demonstrate Baudrillard's point. The success of models depends neither on David's violent submission, his confinement to an enclosure, nor his persuasion. Instead, David's body is subjected to a viral regime of molecular linkages and data transfers that conform to his organism, radically disrupting it in the process. Cyberpunk Edgerunners is explicit in its depiction of cyberware's violent interfacing with the body, not just its militaristic function. In several bloody sequences, David visits the Ripper Doc, an unlicensed surgeon who implants cyberware for a discounted price, repeatedly opening, cutting into, and penetrating his body. During David's final transformation in the penultimate episode, David willingly subjects himself to a complete dismemberment as he installs the cyber-skeleton. It is clear that cyber-psychosis is not possible outside the ritual bodily mutilation which functions to make the body accessible to a regime of non-representational manipulation. Baudrillard describes the hyperreal body as, quote, the body no longer a functional medium, but the extension of death, the dismemberment and cutting to pieces of a body confused with technology in its violating and violent dimension, in a savage and continual surgery that violence exercises. In Cyberpunk Edgerunners, it seems as though David's body is what undergoes the most radical transformation, while the arbitrariness and circular nature of David's subject position remains static and unchanging. Had Baudrillard seen Cyberpunk Edgerunners, he would surely argue that the plot centers on David's body, while David the subject takes on a vestigial form, simply trailing behind his accelerating body. And under these conditions, how do we define David the subject and his capacity to act? Although David leaves Arasaka Academy, an enclosure that functions to discipline children into valuable laborers for Arasaka, he is nonetheless fully instrumentalized and proves to be even more valuable to Arasaka outside of the academy, even while consciously resisting all that it stands for. David might refuse labor, but Baudrillard explains how the refusal to work is integrated into reproduction. He says, quote, Labor, even in the guise of leisure, pervades every aspect of life in the form of a control, a permanent occupation of spaces and times, regulated according to an omnipresent code. Your quotidian roots are no longer savagely ripped up in order to hand you over to the machine. You, your childhood, your habits, your relationships, your unconscious drives, and even your refusal to work are integrated into it. In Night City, enclosures such as the school and workplace are already generalized across society and still exist in physical form to veil a system of control that is instead already modular, code-like, and automatic. Unable to recognize the modular reality of control, David embarks on a path away from enclosure and stratification, like the Deleuzian schizophrenic, but actually deeper into a web of modulation and manipulation. David certainly occupies the cyberpunk position, choosing a lifestyle opposed to conformity, yet it doesn't matter in Night City, where choice yields more effective control over the subject. On the surface, David is addicted to cyber augmentation and dependent on psychosuppressants. However, he is not simply an addicted cyberpsycho. There are comorbid and subtler dynamics at play that demonstrate David's orbital trajectory and his inability to escape the system. David is animated by two opposing desires embodied by his parental figures, his mother and his father figure, Maine. His mother wished for his successful integration into society as an Arasaka executive. Maine offers David an alternative ideal as an ascendant cyberpunk outlaw. While David follows in Maine's footsteps and rejects the system that failed him, his mother and her desire haunt him throughout the show in two ways: as a psychic struggle that intensifies as he grows more violent and descends into cyberpsychosis, and, importantly, as an Arasaka experiment that turns David into an oblivious test subject.
The last thing David's mother communicated to him before she died was her singular desire for him to lead a successful life as a high-level Arasaka executive. David immediately retracts his desire to drop out and offers his sincere apology, demonstrating that he deeply cares about his mother's desire. After the fatal car crash, David loses all financial security and enters a rageful depression, stricken by guilt and impotence regarding his mother's desire. David reacts to his impotence by replacing his spine with a Sandevistan, which augments his strength and speed far beyond the average person in Night City. After nearly crippling his bullies at school and cementing his suspension from the academy, David is immediately tagged as a person of interest by top-level executives at Arasaka for his unmatched cyberware tolerance, and is thereafter secretly selected to be a test pilot for a new experimental cyberskeleton. David's first use of the Sandevistan and his first firm rejection of the system led directly to a deepened integration with the system. The more David's resentment grows, the deeper he descends into cyberpsychosis, the closer he comes to fulfilling the role that Arasaka had engineered for him. David remains clueless about Arasaka's plans and their close observation of him up until the penultimate episode, where he uses the experimental cyberskeleton to handily wipe out a Militech convoy, demonstrating the new technology's capabilities to Arasaka executives and investors. Once Arasaka's demonstration proves hugely successful, they no longer have any use or need for David, the cyberpsychotic punk, and deploy Atom Smasher to kill him. The viewer is faced with the indeterminacy and commutability of David's two opposing dreams: outlaw, mercenary edgerunner, and Arasaka executive. Laboring for the corporate state or resisting the corporate state. Integrating into the system or punkishly rejecting it. From the beginning, David is operating within a matrix of control that collapses the distance between these two seemingly opposed paths, substituting one for the other. The collapse is fully realized when David stands on the roof of Arasaka, teetering in and out of cyberpsychosis, and announces to his dead mother that he has made it to the top floor of Arasaka.
Despite his conscious refusal of control, David appears to be unable to do anything without simultaneously producing value for the system of control he lives within. Baudrillard states that, quote, the subject is trapped in the factitious, differential, encoded, systematized aspect of the object. It is the passion for the code which, by governing both objects and subjects, and by subordinating them to itself, delivers them up to abstract manipulation. David cannot break free from the logic of the system because all desires, the process of desiring itself, are inevitably mediated and consumed by a diffuse network that leads nowhere except towards its own reproduction. Capable of accommodating any desire, such a network in turn warps the desiring process by offering the subject a choice without those limits that kept desire grounded in morality, normativity, or hierarchy. The result is gravitation towards excess, addiction, circular and repetitive behavior. As a subject of Night City, David is made to accelerate within a circuit. His rebellion against society is channeled into his addiction to cyberware and his involvement in the black market economy of Night City. David is technically free to act, but within Night City, all actions lead to the same place.
As a subject of Night City, a Baudrillardian hyperreality, David is made to accelerate within a circuit. His rebellion against society is channeled into his addiction to cyberware and his involvement in the black market economy of Night City. David is free to act, but within Night City, all actions lead to the same place. All the movements that only play on liberation, emancipation, on the resurrection of a subject of history, do not see that they are already going in the direction of the system. This is what we mean when we say that David's trajectory is orbital. David is on a path leading nowhere, but leading there faster than others.
In conclusion, for Baudrillard, our hyperreal orbit is sustained by the monopoly capitalism has on culture and political economy, regulating all social relations according to a self-referential system of rules of pure operationality and efficiency he calls the code. As capitalism develops and continues to purify those mediums of exchange, the varied systems of representation and production give way to a singular system of reproduction. Representation can no longer stand in for the real or the original. Instead, representation stands in for itself to function as the real. It is not so much that reality has entirely been replaced by illusion, but that the question of reality versus illusion is thrown out entirely. Under these conditions, capitalism can function at its maximal efficiency, infinite speculation, unrestrained privatization and commodification, and unfixed valuation. Baudrillard argues that capitalism achieved its purest form with the generalization of simulation and inaugurated a society where value is no longer determined according to difference or structural positionality, but instead becomes unfixed, determined by circulation and speed. The dialectics of history and subjectivity have been, in a sense, resolved, or collapsed, by a totalizing order of simulation that passively undermines all possibilities for truth, meaning, and effective politics. This is hyperreality, where a fragmented social reality is unmoored from those boundaries and limits that gave our experience meaning. History stops moving, yet the subject feels as though they are moving at impossible speeds, where once definable landscapes and objects blur out of focus. We are pulled into the gravity of a collapsed space, kept in orbit by our past momentum whose original conditions are lost. The subject is integrated into a symbolic economy of the code. Resistance within the system only serves to reproduce the system that it resists. Baudrillard says, even while rebelling against content, one more and more closely obeys a logic of the code. For Baudrillard, it is clear that hyperreality and simulation are totalizing and override subjectivity entirely. That concludes the second part of our series on cyberpunk edgerunners. In the next part, we will again challenge the theories of the previous part, in this case Baudrillard's theories, using Lacan's understanding of language and his theory of the subject. Stay tuned. Thanks for watching.